Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Chanzom. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Thursday, the 18th of February. India's Prime Minister Modi calls for cooperation among South Asian nations for COVID-19 vaccination. Malala Yousafzai questions Imran Khan Pakistan Army over threatening post by Taliban terrorist. And continued violence in Afghanistan will jeopardize peace, says top US commander Miller. And now for all the details. Thousands of farmers gathered at railway stations and blocked trains in parts of India on Thursday as part of their months-long agitation against the three new contentious farm laws. A deadlock continues to persist as the government has refused to repeal the legislation, a key demand of the protesting farmers.
Farmers agitating against the three contentious farm laws gathered at railway stations and blocked trains in parts of India on Thursday in an attempt to pressurize the government to repeal the new agriculture reforms, which they believe will hurt their livelihood. The protesters sat on railway tracks and some also lied down while waving flags and raising slogans as part of the nationwide rail blockade call given by an umbrella body of around 40 farmer unions. Farmers fear the laws will leave them at the mercy of big corporate buyers, gradually ending the current practice of assured government purchases. The four-hour rail blockade protest took place amid heightened security, with railway authorities stopping most trains as a precautionary measure.
लगातार हमारा केंद्र सरकार के खिलाफ है जब तक वो काले कानून वापस नहीं लेती बिजली शोध बिल और पराली का जो पोल्यूशन एक्ट 2020 बनाया है वो वापस नहीं लेती किसानों पर किए हुए झूठे पर्चे और जो जेल में किसान जो जेल में फेंके उनको वापस बाहर नहीं निकालती पर्चे रद्द करके ये हमारा आंदोलन ऐसे चलता रहेगा
प्रोमिनेंट फार्मर लीडर राकेश टिकैत ऑन थर्सडे वॉर्न्ड that the center government should not think that the farmers' agitation will end in just 2 months. It will continue till the laws are scrapped, he said. The federal government has offered concessions to the farmers but has refused to repeal the three laws passed last September that it says are crucial to bring new investment to the sector, which accounts for nearly 15% of India's 2.9 trillion economy and about half its workforce.
As coronavirus pandemic continues to pose a threat in some countries around the world, Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Thursday urged leaders of neighbouring countries to think about special visa scheme for doctors and nurses for quick travel during health emergencies. The remarks were made during a workshop on COVID-19 management which was attended by 10 neighbouring countries.
Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi, while addressing a workshop on COVID-19 management, on Thursday called on leaders of neighboring countries to maintain a cooperative and collaborative spirit in the development of vaccines against coronavirus. PM Modi suggested a special visa scheme for doctors and nurses for quick travel during health emergencies just like COVID-19.
Can we consider creating a special visa scheme for our doctors and nurses so that they can travel quickly within our region during health emergencies on the request of the receiving country? Can our civil aviation ministries coordinate a regional air ambulance agreement for medical contingencies?
This comes as Indian government claims the COVID-19 vaccination coverage in the country has crossed 9.4 million mark, ranking India at the third position after the United States and the UK. cases of coronavirus across the country have gradually reduced, except Western Maharashtra state, which is facing a surge in the infection cases again.
Moving on, Pakistani Nobel laureate Malala Yousafzai has questioned Prime Minister Imran Khan and the military leadership about the escape of Ehsanullah Ehsan, a Pakistan Taliban terrorist, from government custody after he threatened a second attempt on her life, tweeting that next time there would be no mistake. Twitter on Wednesday permanently suspended the account with the menacing post. Former spokesperson of Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan terrorist outfit Ehsanullah Ehsan, who took the responsibility for having shot Malala Yousafzai in 2012, has now threatened the Nobel laureate by posting on Twitter, next time there would be no mistake. The threat by Ehsan prompted Malala to question Pakistan's military and Prime Minister Imran Khan on Twitter to explain how her shooter Ehsan had escaped from the government's custody. Meanwhile, Twitter has permanently suspended Ehsanullah's account on Wednesday. Ehsanullah Ehsan 9 years ago had shot and wounded Malala Yousafzai. The escape of Ehsan in 2020 created an uproar in Pakistan, where the opposition has accused the government of sheer incompetence. Ehsan had disclosed that on January 11, 2020, he had managed to escape from the custody of Pakistani security authorities, but no confirmation has been made by the Pakistan Army yet. Ehsan was involved in one of the most gruesome attacks on Pakistani children when suicide attackers on December 16, 2014 entered school, shooting indiscriminately, killing 149 people, including 132 students. Amid the growing atrocities against the ethnic Baloch in Pakistan, PMLN Party Vice President Maryam Nawaz has urged Prime Minister Imran Khan to speak to the relatives of the Baloch missing persons who are protesting in capital Islamabad. Activists accuse a large number of Baloch civilians have been allegedly abducted by Pakistan Army and spy agencies and kept in torture cells.
Pakistan Muslim League Nawaz or PMLN Vice President Maryam Nawaz on Wednesday urged Prime Minister Imran Khan to speak to the relatives of the Baloch missing persons who have been staging a protest in Pakistani capital Islamabad to know the whereabouts of their loved ones. The opposition party leader said the government should inform the relatives of the missing persons of their fate, adding that the victims are victims and should not be associated with any province. She said if anyone has committed a crime, then they should be tried in courts, not in torture cells, while describing the government's missing persons commission as an eyewash.
Riyasat ka farz hai. Riyasat maa ki tarah hoti hai. Maa ki tarah hota hai. Aapka farz hai ki agar aap inko ye nahi bata sakte ya aap inke pyaron ko baaze aap nahi kar sakte, aap ye to kar sakte hain ki jinke log is waqt torture cells mein hain, aap inko bata dein ki inke pyare kahan hain.
A large number of Baloch political activists, intellectuals and innocent civilians have been missing for years. They have allegedly been abducted by Pakistan Army and spy agencies and kept in secret cells. Activists blame that there has been a sharp rise in human rights violations in Balochistan since the launch of multi-billion China-Pakistan economic corridor, which has also led to displacement of Baloch people.
Moving on to news from Sri Lanka. The Sri Lankan Parliament has cancelled the planned address of Prime Minister Imran Khan during his upcoming visit to the island nation. Khan is scheduled to travel to Colombo on a two-day trip from February 22. Reports suggest the decision has been taken because of concerns that Imran Khan could rack up the Kashmir issue during his speech, which could have upset India. It is said that the speech to Parliament had been included in Khan's itinerary on Pakistan government's request. However, it was later cancelled. Sri Lankan media have cited different reasons for the cancellation of Khan's address. While Delhi Express quoted Foreign Secretary Jayanath Kolumbage as having said the cancellation was requested by the speaker on the pretext of COVID-19. There's another speculation doing the rounds is that the government was concerned about Khan speaking about the rights of Muslims in Sri Lanka. Earlier this month, the government exempted the Muslims from cremation and allowed them to bury their dead after a global outcry over the issue. In news from Afghanistan, Amid rising violence and stalled peace talks between the Afghan government and the Taliban, commander of US and NATO forces in Afghanistan, General Austin S. Miller, has said that continued violence will make peace process very difficult.
The commander of US and NATO forces in Afghanistan, General Austin S. Miller, has said that if the violence isn't reduced, it's going to make a peace process very, very difficult, and it would be very difficult for any side to make the necessary compromises. Miller said that the fighting now was an indicator that not only would there be a spring offensive, a move many diplomats view as against the spirit of the Doha Agreement, but that it could be more intense than before. The remarks come as negotiations between the Afghan government and the Taliban have largely stalled in Doha, and negotiators from both sides have left Qatar, leading to growing fears that talks could be on the brink of collapse. Meanwhile, countries like New Zealand and Germany have expressed concern over the rising violence in Afghanistan and stalled peace talks. Where Germany has warned against swift withdrawal from Afghanistan, New Zealand has confirmed it will pull out its last six troops from the war-torn country by May. New Zealand is the first foreign government to confirm a withdrawal since peace talks began and coming at an uncertain period for the process as violence rises.
In news from Nepal, Nepal's Prime Minister K.P. Sharma Oli, while expressing will of his government, has said the Himalayan nation wants to manage the Bhutanese refugee problems in a timely manner. Oli made the remarks in a meeting with the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees in Nepal.
Nepal's Prime Minister K.P. Sharma Oli has told the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees in Nepal, Colonel Spenneth Verma, that his country wants to manage the Bhutanese refugee problems in a timely manner. According to the Prime Minister's Secretariat, in his meeting with Verma earlier this week, Oli said that the government's first priority is to create a favorable environment for those refugees languishing in Nepal to return to their country with dignity. But if that did not happen, the government was open to work on other options like relocating them to third countries. The vast majority of Bhutanese refugees are Lhot Shampa, a Hindu population of ethnic Nepali descent. They have been living in refugee camps in eastern Nepal for the past 17 years since being evicted from their homes by the Bhutanese government, which introduced a law stripping them for their citizenship and civil rights because of their ancestry.
Eating insects or entomophagy is nothing new and is considered a major sustainable food source. A farmer in India's northeast Manipur state has ventured into rearing edible insects, which is part of their diet and considered a delicacy. Insects are consumed for their nutritional, economic and ecological benefits. Ningthaujam Max Singh, a farmer from northeastern Manipur state, is rearing edible insects. Eating insects or entomophagy is nothing new here. The traditional diets of many communities in the state include insects for their nutritional, economic and ecological benefits. Ningthaujam's farm is located at Payang Khedangbang village in Kangpokrit district in Manipur. The farm plays host to thousands of worms, crickets housed in a shelter that has been modified to mimic the dark environment conducive for the insects to thrive.
Oga charamba adu asai gi pesticide kumba insecticide kumba sinarak pada lerakta budu da adu gi mahau da koina sum kawungam da da adu sum koina sum masi je kali kumba yaragadi revive to buya bra hebu gi wakalon da toraga ngapsa gi bani.
Ningthaujam ventured into insect farming a few years ago and he says crickets are so far his best. In addition, insects can be reared on organic side streams and can help reduce environmental contamination, he added.
Koi manaba rajugi magi harok to buse na he kra kra lowe sa ba potin ju phai kolenga no bije besu to we na du lai ra kole.
Though anthropologists see the stigma associated with entomophagy in some societies do exist, the UN Food and Agricultural Organization estimated in 2013 that at least 2 billion people around the world eat more than 1,900 species of insects as food. Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/asianewsline. and follow us on Twitter at Asia Newsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button. Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.